Welcome back on this Wednesday edition of Washington Watch. I'm Sarah Perry. In a year rife with protests and riots, right and wrong beliefs, calls to defund the police, good and bad groups, Black Lives Matter, and Supreme Court decisions expanding once settled definitions, an important book has just been released. Mike Gonzalez, a senior fellow in the Douglas and Sarah Allison Center for Foreign Policy at the Heritage Foundation, has written a new book and joins me now. The book is The Plot to Change America, How Identity Politics is Dividing the Land of the Free. Mike, welcome back to Washington Watch.
Sarah, thanks a lot for having me on. You're one of my favorite interviewers, so I'm very pleased to be here with you.
Well, thank you. I got to tell you, never has there been more of an apt book for this year. I think when we all started, we find ourselves sort of with spinning eyes, thinking we've had to deal with everything from economic unrest to a pandemic to social unrest. And here comes a book about identity politics. And really, if there is a theme to this year that we are working hard to counter, it's the notion of divisions, the way we divide ourselves from one another. So the book is called How the Entirety, right? So Identity Politics, How It's Dividing the Land of the Free. Talk a little bit about the destructive characteristics of identity politics.
Yes, so you're absolutely right. I finished writing this book, obviously, last November. Little did I realize that it was going to be so timely. I'm elated that the book is so timely because I want the ideas to get out. But I'm very saddened as to why it is timely. It means the country is in really dire straits. Now, what do I mean by I want the ideas to get out? What I set out to do with this book is to really shed light, to expose why we're so divided. What is identity politics? Identity politics is the division of America into groups that are based on race, ethnicity, sexual orientation, gender, even disability status, right? Anything
right.
That gives a member of one of these groups a claim on victimhood, that they can say, my victimhood entitles me to attention, to respect, to dignity, to compensatory justice, or to rewards. And that is as you can imagine, and your listeners right now are imagining, that is a very bad way to order society. And
sure.
Yet, this is what we have done. This is exactly what we have done. Now, what I set out to do with my book is to shed light on this, to describe who did this, why they did it, what has happened, how they did it, and what we can do about it. It is, as you said, very timely in the summer of 2020, and I hope the ideas get out and we become woke to the woke.
So, first of all, I love that because this really is the attempt at becoming woke to the woke, because that's another one of the themes for this year, is sort of wokeism run amok, right? We don't know how to have civil discourse with our fellow man. We're not allowed to sit down and have disagreeing concepts hashed out and still be friends at the end of the conversation. But instead, in some parts of the country, it's devolved now into moral and societal chaos. So the book dispels a number of the myths about identity politics. And one of the myths that your book dispels is that identity politics itself is not a grassroots movement. It feels that way. It presents itself that way. I give you the Women's March movement, although it has since fizzled because identity politics, shock and awe, appeared to be its undoing. Some were anti-Semites, some were not. And after a while, the snake ate its own tail, and the Women's March is a shadow of what it once was. So talk a little bit about why this is not truly a grassroots movement.
So I'm so glad you asked that question, because that is the first myth to be dispelled, that this is a clamor from bottom up, people asking for recognition. No, this is, if you look, as I have, and I did the research, you look at when the groups were first created, when the identities were first assigned. This was all an elite project. Let me give you a single example. The Ford Foundation gave UCLA researchers a lot of money to go to the Southwest, to California, to canvas Mexican Americans. They canvassed a lot of money, especially back then. They came back with the information, which made the UCLA people aghast, that Mexican-Americans actually did not feel like they were victims. They did not feel like they were members of minorities. They faced discrimination, and they knew that, but they thought they could solve their own problems through individual agency and action. And that is not what they wanted to hear. So they set out to do the hard work of instilling grievances into people, then create the Hispanic identity, the Hispanic synthetic pan-ethnicity that the activists forced the government to create. So OMB has to comply and create this identity as well as Asian Americans in 1977 through policy directive number 15, and then it's applied to the census, and now we have it all around us. But this is nobody wanted this. Let me just give you one more example, if you will allow me to.
Yes.
MENA, Middle East North Africa, was about to be created. President Obama wanted to create it. In 2015, they bring in a lot of activists, a lot of really lefty professors and activists, into the Census Bureau, and they have a conversation about how to create MENA. They're trying to use Hispanics as a model. And people begin to say, and I quote them, the video is online, look, people don't want this. Americans of Arab descent do not want to be formed into a group. And the activists say, aha. But once you understand that this is associated with assistance, which is associated with, easy admissions to college, or with a set aside in government contracting, they will like it. So they are that cynical. It's at that cynical level.
Yes. You know, it's very interesting to me that you've described this in a way I've never heard it described before, but yet makes perfect sense, about this notion of there being sort of an identity trance, that it's so easy to buy into the notion of belonging to these segmented groups and taking your singular identity from what characteristic you happen to have. I, for example, have a son who is on the autism spectrum. I don't call him autistic. I say my son Noah, who has a diagnosis of, so it's not who he is, it's just a function of what he has. His person is separate from his characteristics, from his diagnoses, from the color of his skin. But you talk about this being an identity trance, so it holds a lot of appeal, particularly among the younger generation. Why is that?
Well, because this is all they have heard. Christina Mora, who is a liberal professor from California, she talks about a process of collective amnesia in which people begin to forget that these identities didn't exist before. They think they have been around forever. And so if you talk to a millennial, they think that, you know, the Hispanic identity has been around since Roman times. They don't know that it was created by OMB in a neon-lit room in 1977.
Right.
So people buy into this. And obviously, as you well know, and you've had many people on your show tell you, our educational system has been co-opted into doing this work, into instilling grievances into people. This is something that your listeners should be aware of, because we need to know what's happening.